We're on this last message from this series. And we've tried, and as I say this, I don't know how successful I can define how we've been in the idea of renewing or reviewing and renewing the whole issue of our mission and vision. The elders in the process of that, and we're trying to figure out exactly where have we been, where are we now, and where are we going. And I think it's important thus we realize that as we've looked at Ephesians 3 and 4, that there are here in this passage, there are what I call four fundamental factors that are provided by Paul to influence and impact how successful we're going to be in ministry. And last Sunday, I had the privilege of attending the church where Donna and I got married almost 40 years ago. And it's the first time I've been in that church, first time I've been there since other than a wedding in the early 90s, first time I'd been there since 1979. And I found it interesting because I looked around, I really didn't know too many people. Sat next to my sister, so obviously I knew her. But as I heard the pastor, now I'm just going to say this, and I say this again cautiously, but the pastor did a great job. It was a great message I heard, but he showed a video at the beginning of the message that I would never show. Because it was on an edge of theology that to me was something that we don't need to embrace. And, you know, I say that and I express that. Why? Because as we look at how successful we're seeking to be, as we look at what we're trying to do as a church, we have to weigh all the different things that are going on. We have to evaluate. We have to know where are we right now and where are we really going to head? And I express that, and we've looked at these first three things. Today we're looking at the last one. Several weeks ago we looked at the whole idea of our faith, our trust. Do we trust in a trustworthy God? Do we have an absolute belief that God is God? I can say that almost every single day my faith not necessarily is put in crisis, because I don't know that I have crises of faith. But my faith is challenged almost every single day. It's challenged because I have to say, okay, am I going to do things the way that I would want to do that, or am I going to trust in a trustworthy God? So the first thing is trust. Second one, equipping. We're learning that passage. We'll touch on this very briefly this morning, that we as a body of believers, one of our main responsibilities is to be equipping one another that we might go out and do the ministry. Next Saturday, we have the oil change. 35 people coming. You know what? Let's make it 70 people. And as I say that, that may be a little crowded. But nonetheless, you know, we need to be equipped to do ministry. And one thing that could happen next Saturday, and I say this, it's maybe late to do that, you could be mentoring somebody else on how to share the gospel. You could bring somebody alongside of you and say, you know what, let's go and talk to the people and you watch how I try to engage conversation with them. Maybe somebody can learn how to change oil. That's a possibility too, but nonetheless equipping and prepared for effective service. Thirdly, we looked a couple weeks ago at the whole concept of our ambition. Our ambition, do we want to glorify God? I guarantee that we, again, every day we are challenged in some way or another to please ourselves. But yet, God's called us to bring honor and glory to Him. That should be our ambition. And finally, the whole question of maintenance. What are we doing for maintenance? Are we striving for maturity? Are we striving for unity? Or are we stepping back and saying, you know what? It's good enough the way it is. Let's just keep on keeping on and not worry about improvement. That's a question mark. So we look at that. Now this morning it's maintenance. That's where we're going. And now I ask a question here. How often do I think about maintenance? I could even ask why or how do we think about maintenance? You know, I look at the springtime and I realize, all right, I got all kinds of branches in my yard, and I don't even know the rules around here as how I get rid of those branches. And you know, I look at maintenance. I think in the fall of cleaning out my gutters and all that sort of thing. How often do I think about maintenance? What do I think about maintenance? In fact, oil change? Is that maintenance? Yes. I had a friend one time that said, you know, my car's running kind of funny, and I don't know what's wrong. And I said, well, have you had it tuned up? No. When's the last time you changed the oil? Well, I've never changed the oil in my car. And I looked, and you know, this person had gone like 40,000 miles without change. I'm wondering, it's amazing to me that it even still had oil in it. So, you know, or mow the lawn, trim the bushes. Is that what you think about maintenance? Clean out the gutters. Or, okay, dental checkup? I run as fast as I can. I was at the dentist a few weeks ago, and, you know, that was my 5-year checkup, you know? No, it wasn't. I go more often than that. But nonetheless, health screenings. Is that maintenance? Yes, it is. How about balancing the checking account? Is that maintenance? Yeah. But now, how often do we consider maintenance on our spiritual lives? How often do we stop and think, how well am I doing and what do I need to do to make progress? How often do I consider those aspects and think about, okay, God, what do you want from me? Now, we're looking at Ephesians chapters 3 and 4 over the last few weeks, and I just throw this up on the screen because I am a firm believer. Some people say, I don't care about this that you're doing here, this. But I care because, you know what, I never want God's Word to be misunderstood in a way that we force a meaning upon what the Bible says. We always pull meaning from the Bible, we don't give meaning to it. And therefore, Ephesians 1 through 3, Paul writes and gives us the foundation for our faith. He says, you know, we're saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast. And he goes through this and he basically gives us principles of theological truth that come to us and they make a difference in our lives. But how do they make a difference in our lives? Well, he wrote chapters 4 through 6 where we see the functions of our faith. Not just the foundation, but we move on and see the functions of our faith, and therefore we have, how do we practice the truth? And this section that we're looking at, these sections we've looked at over these last few weeks, they're right there on the cusp in between the foundation and the function. The foundation makes a difference because truth is truth, and we must live by the truth. And therefore, we must function inside of that truth and live our lives in respect to what the truth says. And that's so vital, that's so important. And that's why I look at this, the context of what we're looking at today. We're moving from, here's the fact of the matter. You're saved by grace through faith. You don't earn it. And since I'm saved by grace through faith, what do I do? How do I function? How do I act? And that's what we're looking at. And the passage itself, this is my translation of this passage written in such a way to try to draw the highlights out. And he says in this passage, beginning in chapter 4, verse 1, he says, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of your calling. I urge you to do that, he says, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. Being diligent to maintain. There's that word maintenance. Being diligent to maintain the unity, the oneness of the Spirit that exists within the bond of peace that we all enjoy. Going on and seeing verses 12 and 13, he says, the church should be, the leadership of the church should be equipping the saints for ministry. A ministry that builds up the body of Christ. How long do we do that? Well, until we all are unified in our belief and knowledge of the Son of God. Until we all are like a mature person who measures up to being like Christ. And then he says in verses 14 through 16, therefore, as a result, the result of that is that we are no longer to be children. We're no longer like children, influenced by different doctrines that are out there around us, by humanism or by deception. But rather, because we speak the truth in love, we are growing up to be more like Christ. And we work together with the Lord's strength and support. And as everyone does his or her part, the body grows more and more. That's our passage. And what we're doing today is we're going to consider three ideas about maintenance. Three things that tell us about what does it mean to be doing appropriate spiritual maintenance in our lives, and in our church, in our ministries. What's that mean? And the first thing I want to say, very frankly, it's key that we cover this one first. When we fall into the maintenance mode, and I didn't even know this. I had this in my sermon notes. I was writing it down, and I decided, you know what, I'm going to look for illustrations and see what I can find. And I did a Google search. And did you know maintenance mode is a term that's being used today, and it's a negative term. When a piece of software by a software company is considered in the maintenance mode, they're shelving it. They're putting it away, saying, we don't use this anymore. So I found that interesting. And when we fall into maintenance mode, let's realize that's dangerous. It's dangerous. And look at the passage there. He says, I urge you. There's that sense of urgency that Paul writes here. I urge you to walk in a manner that's worthy of your calling. I urge you to do that. And then he describes, he says, with humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. And he closes that section out by saying, being diligent to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. But now I ask the question, am I becoming too content? Am I becoming too content? Because there's this sense where I say, well, you know what? Years and years ago, in fact, back in 1990, we added a room to the home that we owned down in Illinois. We added a family room. And there were several people. I had a contractor that was helping me, and I took 2 weeks off of work at the church where I was pastoring, and this contractor came and helped every day for those 2 weeks. And several folks came and volunteered to help out with that. They wanted to help the pastor. And there was this joke that as they would nail a board or do something else, they said, well, it's good enough for who it's for. In other words, hey, you know what? We can be content with this. It's good enough. In our ministry today, are we saying, well, it's good enough. Could be better, but it's good enough. Are we becoming too content? Are we resting on our laurels? We're saying, you know what? Years ago, this church was large and there were lots of different things going on and that was great and you know what? It's okay the way it is now. Got to ask ourselves, am I becoming too content? Maintenance mode says, I'm settled. Or secondly, am I becoming complacent? And you know what? I'm less concerned about contentedness than I am about complacency. Complacency is our enemy. Complacency says, you know, I'm tired. I've been doing this for so long. I didn't train anybody else to take my place, but somebody else can take over. And that's not healthy. In fact, ministry maintenance is essential. But realize that when we go into maintenance mode, we normally stop trying to advance and move forward. And I think it's key that we keep in mind that we have this mindset, we have this perspective, that we realize God is always calling on our lives with a sense of urgency, with a sense of we got to keep on keeping on. We're like airplanes. You know what happens when an airplane stops progressing, stops moving forward? It crashes. Back lots of years ago, this was a funny experience. Got to know when I was in the Army and got to know a helicopter pilot. He called our office one day and he says, "You guys have any days where you can take off an afternoon?" And there were two of us and that he was talking to. "Yeah, we can do that." He says, "Well, hey, I am doing some training. I'm flying to St. Louis next week. You guys want to fly on a Huey to St. Louis?" And wow, that'd be not kind of neat. You know, we weren't Vietnam infantry guys, so flying in a helicopter sounded interesting to us. So we flew to St. Louis, and on the way home, on the way back to Fort Knox, the two pilots, the trainer pilot and the trainee pilot, I saw them talking to you. We had our headsets on. We had helmets on and all that. We could talk to them, but we didn't hear everything they were saying. So I'm talking to each other, and I'm watching the altimeter. And we were up at a very high spot, and I see these guys, they go over and they flip the switches, and they just started to coast. And I'm watching the altimeter, how high we are, and I'm looking, and pretty soon we're down at 5,000 feet. We're only a mile off the ground. And I turned on my microphone and I said, "Hey guys, you going to turn this thing back on?" They started laughing and says, "Well, we were going to do it pretty soon, but we were waiting to see how scared you guys got." And the engine did come back on, obviously, because I'm here. But you know what? We should be concerned when we're starting to drift, when we're starting to coast. We should be concerned because God has called us to a sense of urgency. Urgency for growth. And we dare not afford to settle into a comfort zone that hinders what God wants to do with us and in us. One more quote here. "Christianity is not the faith of those who are complacent, content, comfortable, or even timid. It demands an urgency for maturity and growth. Faithful followers of Christ need to strive for more. And we need to become relentless in a desire to become more and more like our Lord Jesus Christ. Maintenance mode is dangerous." Secondly, maintaining unity requires me to be diligent. That goes hand in hand with the idea that maintenance mode is dangerous. And that's right here in the text. Maintaining unity requires that we would be diligent. And I'll define that word diligent in a few moments, but let's look at the passage one more time and see what it says at the end. Before we emphasize, "I urge you," we emphasize that first portion. Now we're going to emphasize the last portion. Notice what it says. "I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling." Worthy of your calling, "with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace." That word diligent, it's a fun Greek word. In fact, say this with me, spoude. Spoude. You know Greek. Spoude. And the interesting thing about that word is literally, we could say it means to make a focused and concentrated effort. That's a very nice, practical definition. A focused and concentrated effort. But when you look at the word picture that goes with that word spoudē, what the Greeks thought when they heard that word spoudē, they thought the idea that you hold your nose down to the grindstone. You know what that means? That you're being very, very concentrated, very focused. Why? Because you're using the grindstone, and if you don't be careful with that, you're going to lose a thumb. You're going to lose something. You're going to get hurt. Because you need to be attentive. You need to be focused. And literally, that's the word picture that the Greeks had for that word. Keep your nose to the grindstone. And that's that word diligent. And Paul is saying there in that passage, being diligent, being focused, being concentrated in an effort from unity, it says. Now, as we work through the passage here very quickly, first thing he says earlier in that passage is we need to walk in a manner worthy of our calling. And to look at that in a very practical way, that means to balance our conduct with our calling. That our behavior should match our beliefs. Or to live in respect and reverence for the Lord because I am now identified as His disciple. I'm identified as His follower. And I dare say that most people that know you, they know that you either attend this church or maybe that you attend church, or they know that there's a religious aspect to your life. But what do they see when they consider that religious aspect to your life when in fact the conduct doesn't match the calling? What do they think? What do they see? What perspective do they have on Christ? Paul says, make sure that there's a balance between the way you act and the way your attitude projects things. And he's warning us. He says, walk in a manner worthy of our calling. And he defines it even more. He says, with all humility and gentleness. What's humility? Humility is a deep sense of personal modesty. And it recognizes depravity. It recognizes who we are as sinners. And it takes and it receives God's grace and says, thank you. Humility is that understanding of who we are, that we don't save ourselves. It's a deep sense of modesty before a righteous, holy God that says, I need you. I can't do it on my own. He says, so walk in a manner worthy of your calling. Balance the conduct and the calling by showing a sense of humility. Not acting as if we're better than other people. Not acting as if we've got it all together because, you know, I'm good. No, I'm a recipient of God's grace. And notice he says, with all humility and gentleness. Gentleness, what is that? That is the choice to avoid exerting force or power, even though I might be able to do so. And I find it interesting, that is literally the definition of that word. It is the choice to avoid exerting power or force, even though I might be able to. The Scriptures describe Jesus as a gentle, a meek person. Jesus had all power, but He chose. Went to the cross of Calvary. He could have said, hey, I'm going to call 10,000 angels. I'm going to destroy the world. I'm going to just say, hey, this isn't going to happen. But no, He was gentle. He chose not to exert the force or the power that He had. So He's telling us here, He says, we need to make sure that we walk in a manner worthy of our calling by being humble and gentle, not forcing ourselves. He says, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. What's patience? Literally, patience, the word itself is large suffering or long suffering. Macrothumia. But in this context, the word patience, it describes the idea of an endurance even when there is stress or tension. It's an attitude that responds to unpleasant people with graciousness. It responds to fools without complaint. When I see that, you know what I realize? Not only am I not very patient, but I don't know too many people that are. And yet, Paul is saying to us here that if we're going to match our calling as followers of Christ with our conduct, that there needs to be a sense of patience in our lives that says, you know what, I don't judge others. I don't hold myself above others. I'm going to be gracious. I'm going to be understanding. He says, with patience, showing tolerance. Tolerance and love. And I think it's key that we understand that that term, that phrase, is intimately related to the idea of having patience. And it gives us an ability to respond without an overreaction. Again, I look at that and I say, oh boy, have I ever blown it a lot of times. It's so easy to overreact. And let me just comment. I think we need to pray for each other for wisdom and discernment in how we react to certain things that go on around us. That's important. Then what's he saying here? He's saying that we maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And literally that refers to the oneness that we have in Christ, that oneness in Christ that is uniquely and ultimately provided by the presence of God's Spirit in our lives. And understand that unity within the church is only possible because of the peace, the provision, the power, and I could even add another P word, the presence of God's Spirit working within us. It's only possible when we allow the Spirit to control us, because when the Spirit doesn't control us, we're not going to show that sense of humility and gentleness. We're not going to exhibit a patience or a tolerance in love toward one another. We're going to overreact. And that breaks the unity. That breaks the oneness. And let me just say here as we close this point off, I think there are four attitudes here that lead to action. There are four attitudes that he's providing for us that lead to action. And these four attitudes, write down the list. I know there's a little bit of room on the notes. You can write this down. What this next thing that I go through, you won't probably have room to write it down. But he's saying that we need to have dedicated commitment toward one another. Dedicated commitment towards one another. We look around. In fact, look around the room here. Realize we need to be dedicated in committing ourselves to the concern and the care, the best interest of each other. We're a family. We're a body of believers that is to work together to serve the Lord. And with that in mind, dedicated commitment. Secondly, genuine concern for each other. Most of the time, we're too busy to be concerned for other people. We're too focused on ourselves to be concerned for other people. Thirdly, we need to have a sense of attentive consideration. I'll explain that in a moment here. And finally, there needs to be a sense of sincere compassion. And that's all toward one another. What are these? The notes, there's some sets of notes already copied back there in the back. I'll give these out if you want them. I realize for some people you need more paper, like you need, well, I'm not sure what, but you know, this is a paperless society, right? And what's the pastor do on Sunday? He gives you opportunities to get more paper in your lives. Well, dedicated commitment is an uncompromising sense of assurance that we have because we are a family led by God our Father. We're a safe place. We can bear our souls. Before I prayed, I expressed something. I told a story about us. And I wasn't trying to put the center of attention on me or on Donna, but I was trying to say, okay, you know what? We all have experiences in life that have affected us, that have taught us lessons. And we ought to be able to come together on Sundays and have that sense of dedicated commitment where there's assurance that, you know what, I'm with family. I'm with people that love me. Secondly, genuine concern, that's personal interest for one another's well-being. That's a desire for what is best for each other and an effort to be an encouragement to all. It's wanting what is best for each person and for the body of Christ. That's genuine concern. Not this, you know, I'll pretend like I'm concerned and then I don't have to worry about it for the next 6 days till next Sunday comes along. One of the things that disturbs me about our culture today, and notice I said about our culture today, I'm not talking about this church in particular, but I care about this church. But our culture keeps us disengaged from one another. There are far too many people here every Sunday that are totally unengaged with each other. Now, there are a lot of people that are very much engaged. They follow the prayer chain. They ask me, did you know anything about that? Do you know anything about this? I applaud that, but yet we need to stop and ask ourselves, is there genuine concern that I'm showing toward the body of Christ? Am I engaged enough with this body of believers that it feels like a family? Or is it merely something I do on Sunday mornings? Genuine concern. Thirdly, attentive consideration. I could have made this very simple and just said listening. Listening. But to define it, it's being observant toward one another and noticing when encouragement and help are needed. Seeing that look in somebody's eyes that says, you know what, you're not feeling good today, are you? And attentive consideration says, I'm willing to listen carefully to someone else, and I'm not going to cut them off by what I want to say because I want to hear what they have to say. The average listening skills of people today is about zero. Because most people are so focused on, what am I going to say to this person that they don't hear what the other person's saying? I get in a lot of conversations where I'll have something to say, and yet God's taught me. This is not me naturally. God's taught me that forget about what you're going to say, just listen. And I know some of you have heard me, you know, I'm talking to you, we're talking to each other, and I'll say, you know, I had something I was going to say, but I don't remember what it was because I was trying to hear what you had to say. And that's that attentive consideration, and then finally, sincere compassion. That's expressing appropriate love and also understanding in a way to support and encourage one another. And you know what those things add up to? Maintaining unity. Maintaining unity in the bond of peace through the Holy Spirit. That's what they add up to. Now, finally, ministry maintenance is a deliberate strategy for everyone's development toward maturity. It is a deliberate strategy for everyone's development to become mature followers of Jesus Christ who look and live like Christ did. And I think that's so key. That's where we're headed. Oops, that's from last 2 weeks ago's message. Didn't get deleted. What we see here in this passage, notice what he says, verses 12 and 13. He says, equipping the saints for ministry. What kind of ministry? Ministry that builds up the body of Christ. How long? Until we are all unified in belief and knowledge of the Son of God. Like a mature person who measures up to being like Christ. And then verses 14 through 16. Therefore, as a result, we're no longer like children. We're no longer like kids that bicker on the playground. Who are influenced and distracted by everything that comes its way. We're no longer like children influenced by different doctrines, humanism, and deception. But rather, because we speak the truth in love, we are growing up to be more like Christ. And we work together with the Lord's strength and support as everyone who part of the body, they do his or her part. And therefore the body grows more and more. Got five things. Actually, four things. No, five, I guess. I'm sorry. Christ-likeness. That's the ultimate goal of our relationship to God the Father. He wants us to take on the family characteristics. He wants us to be part of the traits of the family. And that means that we become mature individuals who measure up to being like Jesus. And they're growing up to be more and more like Christ. I had a friend that was a professional athlete, and he had a contract with one of the shoe companies, and they put out a poster. This guy was almost 7 foot tall. They put out a poster that was marketed in the area where he played basketball. In fact, it was marketed in two places back in the 70s, 80s, and probably early 90s. And what it was is it fit exactly on the back of a door, a 7 foot door. And it was a likeness of him. And it had inches on there. And kids could stand next and see, how tall am I next to this star athlete? Well, he came and spoke at a father-son banquet that we hosted one time. He was a follower of Christ. Came and spoke at a banquet, and he identified, you know what? He says, I've got those posters all over my house. And it's not like the linebacker from the Packers who likes to see pictures of himself. Never mind. I just thought I'd throw that in. But you know, he says, I got them. He says, I've got one up in my bedroom, literally is what he said. And he says, when I get up and do my devotions in the morning, he says, I look at that poster and I think, okay, I measure 7 feet tall, but when I measure myself next to Jesus Christ, I'm oh so small. And I think we need to stop and realize that we are to be growing up to mature people who measure up to being like Christ. And we're growing up to be more like him. Second, there should be a clarity and consistency in what we believe. A clarity and a consistency in what we believe. And you know what? This has been depreciated over the last number of years. It's been made less important. And I'm sorry, but when I read the scripture, when I read this passage right here, this is a vital thing that we need to have a clarity as to what we believe. There needs to be a consistency in what we believe. There's a oneness in our faith. What it says right here in the passage, one faith, one Lord, one baptism. One God and Father who is over in us and over all of us. And I think it's key that we realize the building up of the body of Christ until we are all unified. Notice it says that in those verses earlier in the passage. The building up of the body of Christ until we are all unified in our belief and knowledge of the Son of God. We are no longer children who are influenced by different doctrines that are out there. We're no longer influenced by humanism and deception. Thirdly, we are controlled by the Holy Spirit. And it relates to our oneness in Christ that is uniquely and ultimately provided by the presence of God's Spirit in our lives. He lives inside of me, so therefore I just say, okay, you can be in charge because you're supposed to be. And I think it's a key. Once again, I'll say it one more time. The unity within the church is only possible when we're allowing the peace, the provision, and the power of God's Spirit to work inside of us. Fourthly, there should be a cooperation and coordination and effort. Cooperation, coordination. We should maintain a sense of understanding of how do we operate together. We are unified in belief and we are working as a unit. It's not competition. It's not a situation where, well, hey, my gift's more important than your gift. We work together with the Lord's strength and support so that everyone does his or her part. And when that happens, it purrs like a fine-tuned machine. And the body grows more and more. And finally, last but not least, there should be corporate cheerleading. Corporate cheerleading. And that is where we are encouraging one another. We are equipping one another. We're exhorting one another. Exhortation goes a little bit on the edgy side of encouragement. But yet, we're told to exhort each other. And we're edifying, we're building each other up because everyone does his or her part. And there's this unified effort where we use our individual gifts, talents, and abilities, what? For the glory of God. We use our individual gifts, talents, and abilities to bring glory to our God and Father Almighty. And I think it's key that we understand that, and as we close, let me just ask, how do I apply this to my life? How do I apply this to my life? I'm not going to go through what else I have on the screen here. But in your bulletin today, there is a supplement sheet besides the visitor's card. There's a supplement sheet in the bulletin that goes along with the message. And if I'd had time, I don't. I was going to just take us through that. It's called our go sheet, goals and objectives. And the first question it asks, what specific aspect of teamwork requires maintenance in my life? I'd like you to take and just go through that and ask, okay, now, am I trusting God the way I should? Am I allowing God's giftings to be the impact and the influence over what I do? Is my ambition to bring glory and honor to Him? And am I doing ministry maintenance? Ask yourself that, and then finally, consider how can I effectively use the gifts, talents, and abilities God has given me, and also look around the room. You know the best way to get more people involved in ministry? Is to go up to them and say, you know what? I just know God could use you in such and such. You've encouraged me in so many ways. You know what? Why don't you consider doing this or doing that along with me here at the church? How can we encourage one another to use our gifts? One of the questions that are always asked, how many people in your church are actually using their spiritual gifts? That's a hard question to answer, but I will guarantee if we get on a process of or a perspective of saying, you know what, I want to encourage others. I want to mentor others. I want to engage in other people's lives. You never know what God might do. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your faithfulness here in our lives. You've done above and beyond what we could ever completely grasp or understand, because you sent Christ to be a Savior who would do something that most of us wouldn't, we probably wouldn't do. And he showed grace, he showed mercy, he showed great love. And as we consider that, we realize he also sends gifts to enable us to be able to do ministry with each other, in each other's lives. And I pray now that as we close off this series of studies, that there could be a real movement amongst us, Father, to engage one another, to engage the culture around us with the truth of your love and grace. And I pray that we might be able to be a real team, a team that makes a difference wherever we are. So God, I pray that you do a special work and help us as we close the service now. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen.